pronounce the name of the beautiful, wonderful gallery here. And he got my name a little wrong. It's such a relief to me. It's my fault. I think this is proof that I have to be one of the luckiest people in the world. I am standing here surrounded by young people, entering a field that has given me more pleasure and a better life than anything I could have imagined when I was your age. And also here are friends and colleagues from the years here to see the art and visit with us tonight. It's wonderful. And I can only hope that your life brings you what the practice of art has brought me. I wanted to say thank you to Bethany and to Bill for this opportunity. It's just been a wonderful experience from start to finish. She's made it so easy and such a wonderful experience to bring my art here. And I think it looks really wonderful in this setting, much better than it did stored in my basement. There are pieces here also that were made specifically for other people on commission, one of which is the wedding party completed earlier this year. And the other, that painting is gracing us here tonight, and I really appreciate that. Others come from years past. I thought it was important to represent my career, since we're talking about a life in art, and since this is the second half of my life. And so some of the pieces I pulled out and repainted this summer was lots of fun. They look a lot better. So as you move around the gallery and look at the art, I hope you'll look at the chronology a little bit, because I'll probably be referencing that in my talk tonight. One of the things I want to say, too, is over the years I've been aware of the kinds of students that come to this program and the kinds of artists who leave it. You are truly blessed to be in this setting with this teacher and this art faculty in this facility with the breadth and depth of the program that you will have here. Being a self-taught artist, I'm particularly aware of the importance of the technical skills you're learning. I don't have those. I don't have the draftsmanship skills, the color theory. I don't even know what all you're gonna learn. I didn't have those things when I started. I have very little of it now. And I'll talk to you a little bit about what that has meant to my attempts to create art. But anyway, I think you're a lucky bunch, and I hope you have a wonderful experience here. I'm pleased by the theme of my show. I chose the world autumnal with the help of my husband, who's here today too, because it's a significant time of year. It's all of us who have gone to school remember what it's like to approach that new school year, that new career, and here you are, many of you beginning a college career with an eye on an art career, as I understand it. I, on the other hand, am in the autumn of my life. Well, just a little bit past, but we'll call it autumn. And that has specific meanings to me as well. And you could also say that I'm in the autumn of my art career, although I heard some really good news on NPR yesterday. They were talking about life expectancies. And when I was starting college, when I was a freshman in 1961, at about that time, a woman's life expectancy was still about 60 years. And today, they're saying, I hope truthfully, that a woman who's reached age 65 has a life expectancy now of 89 years. So I'm getting my paintbrushes back out. I got a long way to go. And a lot of things to think about and ground to cover. But even given the differences in our age and life stage and my lack of art education. I think that we are kindred spirits because we love the life of artistic expression. I don't think, you know, you would be interested in this kind of programming if you didn't have that quality about you. And as much as I love working, and as happy as it makes me to apply paint to a canvas or a board, the other thing I love as much are the relationships that have resulted as a result of this practice. The relationship of being with other artists, of working with other artists, of talking about art and life and meaning with those people. So, on the other part of that are the young people that are my friends and peers in the art world. That there is no age, really, in those kinds of relationships. So basically, you're looking at a young person in an old person's body, I think, in many ways. One thing I just happened upon by coincidence today was lovely, was an article in an art magazine who talked about older artists and how they never really diminish in their ability to create and paint. And in fact, rather than a detriment, age might be a real support to the artistic expression. As we grow older, we're able to foresee the passage of time, and of course it's going more quickly, and we have a tendency and an ability to simplify concepts and ideas, our use of time. And there's one thing I love about being older, it is that, and I do see that in my work, it's always been my tendency, and I think it is reinforced now by my age. I'm going to use notes because I've got a lot of ground to cover. I hope you don't mind. One of the things I've been impressed by over this period of my life, which has actually been about 25 years now, through visits to museums and settings of books in which old, and you know, the antiquities and the religious art of, you know, centuries ago, and the ceramics and the sculpture from early China or other Asian countries, is the completely contemporaneous nature of that work. You can't look at it, you can't look at a painting, look into the eyes, look into the expression, look at the technique, the astounding technique that you see in those paintings and sculptures and other forms of art, and not understand that we're related to those people as well across time. And it's just the most miraculous experience. You know, they live differently in terms of food, housing, the difficulty of life, the adversities they faced, and here I am in my complete comfort. And God knows why. And we are completely in kinship, and I can only hope to move toward or attain some of what those artists did. So that tells me I'm in kinship with you as well. And I like that very much. I'm going to talk a little bit about my life. I hope I won't bore you with that. You know, I was born, my first day of college, I was probably well before most of your parents were born. That was 1961. And I just sort of made a little list of, you know, the span of my life, the kinds of things that have happened, and can only imagine, or can imagine, what you will experience over the span of your life in terms of social and technical change. And the kinds of experiences that you will have. I'm just personally glad to have my iPhone. One of the best things that ever happened, I think. I was born during World War II, which of course was a major war. During that time, the Holocaust occurred. Since that time, many others have occurred. The nuclear nuclear weapons were created, nuclear energy, space flight, the first landing on the moon has happened during my life, the civil rights movement occurred, women's rights have been evaluated and examined, and certainly my life has changed in nothing but wonderful ways as a result. Now, when I first started working, I wasn't allowed to wear a pair of pants. I did wear clothing, and I wore a skirt and high heels, and did my hair, the whole thing. Now I'm wearing girl shoes. They're more comfortable, I gotta tell you. Let's see. Also, the issue of the increased lifespan, which I'll repeat. So I was just a squirt of a kid without much background and no confidence at all. I don't suppose anyone's like that here. Went to college, took my first art class. I'd taken art classes in high school and I loved it. Got no recognition whatsoever. The first painting I attempted to do, we were painting outside and I was doing the river across from the school, and the art teacher came up and said, and took a paintbrush out of my hand and finished the painting for me. So I didn't have wonderful experiences or much support or much education. Hi. Another friend, I will cry before this is over, I guarantee you. So I went to college, and lucky to be there, didn't know what I was doing much, took my first art class, did life drawing, and as you can see, I love color, always have. So in this life drawing class, you know, you're supposed to take a pencil or a charcoal and do a black and white shaded drawing of a human being, and I started out that way, and we were to take them with us to finish up or whatever before we turned them in, and I happened to have some colored pencils in the room. I did it upright. I turned in a drawing with lots of color, and the professor hated it, and I quit the class, and that was it. So consequently, I became a social worker. And as a result, I had a wonderful career. I was able to support my family through that career. Great experiences. It was work, what can I say? And began to think, as my children grew up, I was still a young woman in my 40s and began to notice the art around me and the artists, and I was jealous. I was so deeply envious and could not imagine that I would ever be able to do that. And I wanted to so badly. And I gotta tell you, I had this wonderful man in my life. And a well-kept secret is, if you are married 50 years or longer, it's wonderful. The first 35 years are the hardest. But if you can make it past that, it's the best thing you'll ever know. And the reason I bring that up, I've never acknowledged it before in one of these talks, but as I started putting my thoughts together, I realized, you know, I've always known it, but I realized the profound nature of how he stood by me. And every time I needed an art supply or needed to make a change or try something harder or step out, he's been there. And what a gift that has been, and I just want to say, okay, so I was jealous and mad. So we started going up to Lake Superior, as many people do, and many people are inspired by that environment, as was I. And I brought something along. Mike said, "Pam, you really ought to give it a try." And we were looking at art supplies in a little store in Grand Marais, and they had these little teeny tiny watercolor boxes with little teeny pans of color and a little teeny brush. And they had a little teeny pad of paper. So this is the first watercolor I ever tried to do. And this was in about, oh, 1989, something like that. And if you can't see it, there's a reason. You weren't intended to. The world was never intended to see anything I ever did. But, you know, you keep doing that kind of thing long enough, and you care about it enough, and you want it enough, eventually you're going to wind up with something. And what I wound up with are some pretty huge canvases that cause us to have a van so we can transport them from here to there. And it's wonderful. The process of that was just simply to apply color every day on some piece of paper or something, and I got stacks of just awful stuff. But what a pleasure to do, and I had the time to do it. Every day I got home from work, and I would go somewhere and sit and turn on some music and paint or draw or this or that. And I went through watercolor, acrylic, colored pencil. And one Christmas, my dear Michael presented me with a set of oil colors and some canvases, and that was it. And that's what I've been doing ever since, mostly. I've been doing some other things, but mostly that. So in this show are... the paintings are labeled with years because we are talking about developing a life as an artist. And so I thought it might be interesting to have the years on the paintings, if anyone's interested in following that. You'll see that I started and ended with color, simple forms. I really strive to convey an emotion or a story or a situation through simplicity, and I fail a lot, and sometimes I think I've been fairly successful. Now, the secret is, I don't have any technical training in my background. There are a lot of things I don't know how to do, and that I still would want to do if I had time to learn all those things. I don't, but I derive a great deal of pleasure from what I can, and strangely what happened was that shaped my voice, and I found my artistic voice, and that's a blessing, and I think I'll just take that and go with it where it will take me. Nonetheless, here you are in a school where you can learn all of those basic skills. Plus, I mean, there's videography, there's all the computer technology, there's sculpture, there's painting, there's all those, photography, and the technical means to combine all those things. And the environment in which many of you can work together to create. If I were starting school today, I'd go straight for some of the computer technology, which I've kind of messed with. I got a grant to do some special projects and learned a little bit about that. And it's also rich. So I guess what I want to say to the students is just encourage you, boy, pack in as much as you can and work really hard. And you'll just leave with many gifts, I'm sure. One of the things I wanted to say is that in my life now, because of art, I follow the pleasure principle that I work almost every day. And I do lose a sense of my age or other statuses in life as I work. It's truly the deepest pleasure I think there is in the world, at least for me. And I'm sure many musicians and other kinds of artists, playwrights and actors and actresses, have those experiences as well. So it's the application of color that gets me every time. And that's where I started, was with primary colors. I had no sense of mixing color or no desire to do so. I had yellow, I had red, I had blue, black and white, and that was enough for me. And so I did just a lot of abstract laying of color on different types of grounds. One day I was working on a painting, and I swear this happened. My grandmother's face emerged. The painting is here. It was her, and my mother's face was there. The rest of the painting is abstract. It's all color and, you know, shape and application of paint, but there they were. And it was just the most mystical and wonderful experience. I did two paintings like that, and that has certainly been what has carried me since that time. I don't know who these other people are. except a lot of them had red hair, especially in the beginning, as did my beautiful, strong, dominant mother. And I imagine that there were a few things I was kind of working out, not only about my relationship with her, but my life in the world as a woman. And trying to define what that meant, how I was going to live that life. So you'll see, I think, in my paintings, a certain stillness, a certain weariness, a certain attention to interior life that's shielded. I think and the same may be true today. Women had to be very careful about what they said, what they did, the choices they made, which choices were available. And it was hard. It could be very difficult, especially if you didn't have social supports to encourage full growth. And I'll give a disclaimer to that. Having worked with men in my social work career, primarily, I think it's very difficult to be a man. There are a lot of role definitions, a lot of rules that need to be followed, and a lot of sorting out about what that means to each individual male. So, it kind of goes both ways, but since I'm a woman and that's been my life, my paintings tend to reflect those concerns, I think. I do think, oh, by the way, those three women over there with the hats on, that's my grandmother and her two sisters. I do know who they are. they were born in Kentucky, and I wanted to make a happy painting about that. where was I? More recently, I've been concerned that I've been noticing that because I'm so darn happy, I can't be much of a tortured artist anymore. And life is just too good. So I think, I hope you're seeing some humor and lightness and joy in my work, because that's certainly what I'm experiencing in life. So, yeah. Let's see. How am I doing for time? I have plenty of time.
Or?
I don't have plenty of things left to say, probably. I must say that one of the other themes that has been important to me in my work, I had a grant, and you're not seeing any of that work, and it's really different than this. It was very abstract, and I sort of did an installation with it. I did a video. And it had to do with the fragility of both the physical and psychological fragility of life and the fragile nature of the skin that is really the only barrier between us and the rest of the world. So I did a study of that and hope to continue. That is not particularly happy work. And so we'll see where that goes. I'm interested in the nature of relationships between women, because those relationships were so powerful, and not always in a positive way in my earlier life. But now, a source of complete joy and happiness to me to have a network of friends and people I do in my life. Okay, I'm interested in the meaning of femininity. I think that's really important, apparent in this work, and I think you'll be making new definitions of that, and I envy you that experience. Okay. The other thing, I'm not sure I have all the language I need to talk about it, but finding a life in art, I mean, if you, that's what I've been able to do. I've had two lives. In my second life, I never could have imagined the fullness and richness that it has brought me, and I think that has something to do with doing what you were meant to do in some mystical way. Fortunately, I don't have to earn a living. I am able to sell pieces, and it's very satisfying, and I love doing that. I have the marketing skills of a gnat, but that leads me to say that that's another part of your program that I hope you will benefit from. Looking over Bethany's, our department's website and so on, I can see that you're being guided to being open to all the possibilities that these skills can bring you in the world, and never close your eyes to being innovative and thinking in a broad way about that. I mean, art often doesn't receive school funding, and people kind of take it for granted. Yeah, when people meet an artist and know that that's what they're able to do, they're mystified by it, they love it, they love you for it. They may not want to pay you, but you make sure they do. These are important skills, and we live in such a troubled world with so many problems to solve, and our voices are among those who can best articulate where we've been, where we need to go, and all the spirituality associated with that. And not necessarily the monetary concerns. Nonetheless, when you drive down Main Street or Madison, where it's a shopping area, or down the highway, or you go anywhere, you're surrounded by some artist's input, whether it's graphic arts or a design person, or your clothing, the cereal box, everywhere you look, those skills are apparent. So certainly there's a, and also there's something I want to say about graphic arts. I love to have those skills because they undergird so much of what you can do as an artist. And pay attention to those. And beautiful pieces of art are created by people named as graphic artists. I have a friend here who is one of the best. And many times, their work is never signed. People, don't know who did that. I hope that will change. It's kind of a thing I have with graphic artists. I love them. They're the best. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is take a broad view of the art market. We've got billionaires. There are about 200 people in the world buying all the expensive art. And they hide it away in their mansions, or they donate it to museums, and it's really a high-buck market. And I don't know how people get there or how they do it. I don't need to know. I have a wonderful life amongst my artistic friends here. I can't imagine how it could be better. I can't imagine it would be better if they were bringing down $100,000 a piece. How could it be better? I couldn't. Where am I going with that? Just to say that art market dominated by 200 buyers in the world is a very small piece of what's really happening, although most of the media talks about that as though it's all that's happening. So just keep yourself open to imagine a variety of venues where you might find expression. And through that, as you work through it, people say they recognize my art, and that gives them pleasure that if they were, in another state somewhere else, that if they saw a piece of mine, they might know it was mine. Let me say that no matter where you are, what you're doing, when you've accomplished your goals, the same will be true for you. And that will be an identifier of how you live your life, your values, what's important to you, what matters, the questions you have, the problems you're solving, the making a living, things you're doing. It can show there as well as anywhere else. That's my thinking on it anyway. Okay. So take your skills seriously. Don't let anyone else not take them seriously. See your skills in the broadest context possible. Respect yourself as a professional. Learn the skills that will form the basis of your work, how to present your work, and how to present yourself in the world. And that's all I have to say. Any questions? I'd be happy to answer. I love questions. I'm kind of a ham, so I could go on. Yeah.
You have a very distinctive palette of colors.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very similar throughout the whole show. I'm wondering how much of that is a conscious choice of yours and how much of it is a natural impulse?
I think that it is the latter. I've tried to make different choices. These were done in as an exercise, trying to learn to be a portrait painter, which I am not. And this is living proof. But before I brought these, they all had brown, reddish-brown sienna backgrounds and were very dark. So I spent the last week before bringing my work over to you on painting them. And now I think they're much better. Yeah, this palette is how I started, and I think it's almost a genetic thing. And I know more about mixing color, and I tend not to mix on my palette. I tend to mix right on the canvas, and which is, I guess, a sloppy way to do it or whatever. But that's the pleasure of oil paint also is a pleasure because it's almost like sculpting, and many of my paintings have many, many, many layers. Many layers. Some not so many, but most of them have been painted and repainted. And, I think I compensate for my lack of skill, actually, in shading and contrast and the theory of light and dark by trying to get a light that emanates from within the painting. And I think one of the ways I try to, one of the methods I have is by glazing and layering and layering and layering and layering until I sense something coming back out of the canvas. So, you know, that's just kind of an example of compensating for what I can't do. One of the many things. Yes?
I'm wondering if your process when you start these is you do a lot of drawing ahead of time, or do you do a lot of your decision making while you're painting?
Some of the paintings are taken actually from drawings. One of the important things in my life that I failed to acknowledge are the people, fellow artists in my hometown of St. Peter, who helped educate me. And in fact, I see one of them here. We started drawing together 25 years ago, I think we figured about, when we were all much younger, in the Old Art Center in St. Peter. And I was the only person in the group who could not draw. They were all, like, master degree artists. And how I fell into that, I don't know, but I'm pretty sure Mike encouraged me. And, oh, I was just miserable for months and months. And then all of a sudden, I could draw. So we drew together for years. And, you know, the Art Center got blown away in a tornado. And then it got reestablished in downtown St. Peter. We drew there. We just, you know, there wasn't that particular group anymore. But 3 years ago, we got back together. And here we are, you know, a little older and having more fun and better discussions, and some of them are drawing better. I can hardly draw at all anymore. A long way of saying, some of these paintings were based on drawings. Others were not. Let me show you one that wasn't. The one that was on the postcard, which is one of my very favorite paintings in the world. Because I think it most captures what I would like to do. This one was drawn on the canvas as were the two on the end there. And when I first started painting, all I would do is start applying color in the faces and bodies that emerge from that. And those are still some of my favorite paintings. I don't seem able to do that anymore. I have to be a little bit more thoughtful. Thank you for that question. I did go on and on. Oh, can we find one more? Yes.
Since most of your paintings you have human figures in them, what's your favorite part when you are drawing a human figure?
Oh, the eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, is that right? I think that winds up being maybe the most important part. Hard to say. The hard parts really are the hands. Again, lacking technical skill. In the background of much practice and teaching about how that might be done, the hands and feet. I have absolutely no ability to capture likeness, which I regret. Rather than a part of the figure, is the application of the color and the relationship between the figures, I think, that winds up being my favorite thing to accomplish and work out.
You did mention artists who you've studied or you looked at,
who
inspires you.
Well, I hope you'll help me a little bit. I don't have the language. For the era and the years of the art, but I wasn't sure enough of myself when I started to actually seek instruction. I mean, how simple would that be? go find a workshop or take a class or whatever. But I just couldn't put myself out there, so I had a lot of books. And one of my favorite books was the book by the nun of all the great masterpieces over time. She had a special. Certainly old enough to remember that, maybe not. Anyway, she had a television special about art across the centuries and the most famous and most wonderful paintings. And the ones I were drawn to in the beginning were the paintings that were the most still, the most postured, the least movement. Can anybody imagine what those paintings might have been? They were the religious art, of the churches and the cathedrals and whatever. And I think it was the color and the stillness and the story in the eyes or in the surroundings that I was drawn to. So, because of my lack of technical training and trying to learn. There was much about that stillness in the figure that appealed to me and the application of making a painting. And I wound up liking the result and not feeling the need so much to strive for other expressions. In fact, I worked with a gallery in Minneapolis. And she was really wonderful to me, and she did sell some paintings, but she was always disturbed. And of course, her business was to make money, which she does. She's one of the most successful galleries in the city. That they didn't have a story. My paintings didn't depict a story. So I just finally got sick of that and stopped taking paintings to her. It wasn't worth the stress to me. So who knows, if you're helping, maybe they were successful. There you go. I loved Matisse. I love thank you. Well, I am nervous, so I can't say the name. Van Gogh, the guy who lived with Van Gogh and went to Tahiti. Yes. And the Italian who died young, who did the wonderful portraits. Very simplifying. Well, yes. Mm-hmm. And they're still my guys, I don't care. Well, one thing is, I had a bird I loved. He was my pet, and he was a love bird. And he used to sit on my shoulder in my studio as I worked. And we were very happy together. And he had a long 11 years, and we were a lot of fun. And I love blackbirds and crows. They're very bright and very aggressive and brave. And to me, they sort of represent our connection with the natural world in a simplified manner. And I never really have learned how to paint them. Every time it's a struggle. I'll never be a wildlife artist, that's for sure. Thank you for that question. Any other questions? Well, once again, I thank you for having me, and it's just been a pleasure talking to you, and I just wish you all so much happiness and good fortune in your career. Thank you. I forgot about this part, I think. I brought a present for you from the Art Center of St. Peter, and I think my piece from the St. Peter Art Center.
Did you look at the cat?
Yeah. Look at me, guys. I told you I'm young and hard. Look at my young, beautiful friends. What these are washable tattoos. And I took one of my paintings and had them made for 4th of July celebration of St. Peter this year. So I decided you ought to have one. Yeah, and so I guess they're passing them out. Thanks, guys.